Westdale United Church is situated on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe Mississauga and the land covered by the Williams Treaty. We respectfully acknowledge and honor First Nation people's history, spirituality, and stewardship of this land, wherein our place of worship resides.
Welcome to Westdale.
Welcome to Westdale.
Welcome to Westdale.
Yeah.
Westdale United, it's wonderful to see your glorious shining faces as we gather in the Spirit of the Lord. Children of God, grace and peace to you in the name of God's beloved, in whom we share this glorious morning and whose heart beats even now in Peterborough, in Westdale United, and in you. Made as creative and wonderful people, you are children of God, a blessing, a seeker, a disciple, growing in grace. Each one of you are gifted, chosen, and loved by God. Remember that? Created in the holy image, each one of you are wonderfully made. Scripture saying that you are God's masterpiece. So be still and listen to the day. Touch the breeze of the Holy Spirit. Quiet in your soul. For Jesus welcomes you here just as you are. Graces you with an unconditional love, a peaceful rest, and a yoke that is easy and light. Here we are, the family of God, the body of Christ, welcomed by the Spirit of Christ and held by God's grace. So relax in the Spirit, sway with the music, be captured by prayer. For this is holy ground, and you are holy ground. We are gathered around the sacred fire of the light of Christ that shines within each one of us. I invite you to join with me as we light our Christ candle. I greet the gift of love in you, because that love is God. We are instruments of your peace. Bright and holy God, you move among us when we gather in your name. O Lord, we gather together in your name, and your glory fills this place. We gather at the door of a light-filled dawn, where the gift of hope rises in our soul. But this is the day of new beginnings. Give us this day our daily bread for our journey. Unite us in a creative love. Shine upon the windows of our hearts, where love lives and hope shines bright. Let the peace of this place surround us. Let the hurry and worry from our week fall away. God of grace and God of glory, take our lives and inspire them. Ready us for dreams that send us in a new direction. Dance down and meet us here at the sacred well of our faith. Divine dreamer, cast a glimpse of beauty in the imaginations of all your children. Holy compassion, joy of the morning, God of creation, whose image lies in the heart of all people, move among us today and amaze us. For we take off our shoes, come meet us here. Holy Spirit, dance with us. Bless us, we pray, in the name above all names that fills this place, Jesus, the bread of life. Amen. I invite you to lift up your voices and join in singing Praise with Joy, the World's Creator.
Your voice teaches us to wander. Amen. join me for the scripture reading. The first, the Old Testament reading is Genesis 25, 19 to 34. You can find that in your large Bible. So if you want to follow along on page 28. The birth of Esau and Jacob. Isaac was the son of Abraham, and he was 40 years old when he married Rebekah, the daughter of Bethuel. She was also the sister of Laban, the Aramean from northern Syria. Almost 20 years later, Rebekah still had no children. So Isaac asked the Lord to let her have a child, and the Lord answered his prayer. Before Rebekah gave birth, she knew she was going to have twins because she could feel them inside her, fighting each other. She thought, "Why is this happening to me?" Finally, she asked the Lord why her twins were fighting, and he told her, "Your two sons will become two separate nations. The younger of the two will be stronger. The older one will be his servant." When Rebekah gave birth, the first baby was covered with red hair, so he was named Esau. The second baby grabbed onto his brother's heel, so they named him Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when they were born. Oh, there's more. Esau sells his rights as the firstborn son. As Jacob and Esau grew older, Esau liked the outdoors and became a good hunter, while Jacob settled down and became a shepherd. Esau would take the meat of wild animals to his father Isaac, and so Isaac loved him more. Jacob was his mother's favorite son. One day, Jacob was cooking some stew when Esau came home hungry and said, "I'm starving to death. Give me some of that red stew right now." That's how Esau got the name Edom. Jacob replied, "Sell me your rights as the firstborn son." "I'm about to die," Esau answered. "What good will those rights do me?" But Jacob said, "Promise me your birthrights here and now." And that's what Esau did. Jacob then gave Esau some bread and some of the bean stew. And when Esau had finished eating and drinking, he just got up and left, showing how little he thought of his rights as the firstborn. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The gospel reading is found in St. Matthew. If you want to follow along in your large Bible, it's on page 1175. The most important commandment. After Jesus made the Sadducees look foolish, the Pharisees heard about it and got together. One of them was an expert in the Jewish law, so he tried to test Jesus by asking, "Teacher, what is the most important commandment in the law?" Jesus answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. This is the first and most important commandment. The second most important commandment is like this one, and it is, love others as much as you love yourself." All the law of Moses and the book of the prophets are based on these two commandments. The good news of Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to
God.
with one spoon. Would you pray with me? Spirit God, living word, eternal wisdom, make us wise. Come, holy fire, ageless wisdom, for we are your daughters, we are your sons, and we can't live on bread alone. Holy whisper, breath of life, midwife of change, speak to us in the beating of our hearts and the stirring of our spirits. By your wide grace, show us your narrow door, and give us the language to speak your love in a thousand ways. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Today is First Nations Sunday, so reconciliation. It's really top of mind this week, thinking about reconciliation. And as it happened, I got an email from my aunt, Aunt Diane, earlier in the week, and I hadn't spoken to Diane in many months. And my mom's sister. So we haven't connected for a long while, and I said, yeah, are you familiar with Zoom? And so we connected on Zoom, and we talked, and she lives in Dartmouth now, and it was wonderful to see her. She has such a great smile. She reminds me so much of my mom. And she said, do you remember when we first met? And I said, yes, just like it was yesterday. I was so nervous, she said. You're 8 years old, she reminded me, and I had forgotten my age at that time. I knew I was young. We'd been watching a softball game. My other uncle, Uncle Gerald, my mother is one of nine, and Uncle Gerald was playing softball with the Kinsmen in Glace Bay, in Cape Breton, and we were watching. We were there for the summer. We used to go out for a month every summer, and my brother Brent and I, were watching my Uncle Gerald play. And this man, this stranger, came up to Brent and I and offered us a stick of gum. And remembering what my mother said, you know, don't take anything from strangers. We said, no, we can't take it. And then we asked Uncle Gerald, can we take this? Is this okay? And he said, yeah, you can take it. That's your Uncle Danny. My uncle was a stranger. So we ended up back at Uncle Danny's place watching a Montreal Expos game in the garage on a 12-inch black and white television, and we were up there for quite a while and getting to know my Uncle Danny. He's a coal miner. I've been a coal miner since he was 15, he told me. He aged faster than he should have. He was still young. Two hearing aids. He had a limp, he could hit the ball a mile and barely make it to first base. And we were up there, four guys, my brother and my Uncle Gerald and my Uncle Danny and myself for quite a while. And then I saw a woman who looked a lot like Ma come out the door. And it was there that I met my Aunt Diane, my mom's sister. I remember she came out the door with milk and cookies for Brent and I. And she said, I'm your Aunt Diane. It's a pleasure to meet you. Sometimes reconciliation happens between nations, within families, within churches, between individuals. Sometimes it happens within ourselves. The word reconciliation, Chief Ava Hill, Chief of Six Nations, told me a number of years ago, she said, is a return to peace. To reconcile is a return to peace. Return to peace. Two boys meeting an aunt and uncle whose name they had never heard spoken before led to a meeting between two crying sisters who had only associated heartache and anger with their relationship. Seeing the other as family, as sister, as brother. Then I got to meet two new cousins that I didn't know I had. The other day I saw a woman in the parking lot, a young mother texting, and two little girls were riding their bikes in the church parking lot here in circles, and one was going clockwise and one was going counterclockwise, and you could see them going, and I thought the circle was getting smaller and smaller, and mom was looking at her phone, and thought, should I get up and say something? Said, I could see something. I could see something was going to happen. Maybe, maybe not. I don't know. And what do you know? They just hit each other and they both fell down. I could see something happening, but I was unable to stop it, or at least I thought it was. Somebody hits a softball and it's flying high in the air and there's a car there and there's nothing you can do about it. Gravity, what goes up must come down. Sometimes we can feel like that. Sometimes reconciliation can feel like that. Something's just happening in front of us, unfolding. Jacob and Esau, we heard Janice read so well. Esau is hungry. Jacob Esau is hungry and Jacob is hungry for power. And we just watch it happen. Sometimes we can feel powerless in the face of reconciliation. Things will never change. The pandemic, I think the pandemic, there's a shift in the church and the movement. I think the shift is from what we believe to how we believe. Paul tells us it's about being an ambassador for Christ, being a preacher of good news. Paul says, so if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ. Return to peace. And has given us the ministry of reconciliation, helping others return to peace. That is, in Christ God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. Did you hear that word, reconciliation? It's one of those re-words of the Christian language, redemption, return, resurrection, restore, release. It's about doing something again, in a new way, a new beginning. After Jacob stole Esau's birthright, they didn't talk much or at all. I feel a certain sympathy for Jacob, the second born of twins. He missed the inheritance of the older brother only by seconds. Remember how Esau was born first with Jacob hanging onto his heel, the scriptures say? Jacob was hanging on to his brother's heel. He never let go of that heel until he had tricked Esau out of his birthright, sold his birthright for a bowl of stew. I mean, come on, how good was that stew? I'd like to get that recipe. With his mother's help, it's kind of an interesting story. With his mother's help, he tricks his father into giving him Esau's blessing. Jacob runs away. He leaves town. Jacob has a dream. Jacob's ladder, angels descending, ascending. He's successful, rich beyond his imaginings. 20 years have gone by, the Bible says, and Jacob wants to go home. Jacob wants to go home. He wants to go home, but he is unreconciled with his brother Esau, whose land he must now pass. And he hears that Esau is coming to meet him with 400 men. Placate him, Jacob sends servants ahead with gifts of prized livestock, goats and rams and milk and camels and cows and bulls. The scriptures say he sends all this to Esau because he's terrified. What is his brother going to do? There he has his army of 400 men waiting for him. Retribution. Incredible numbers. Jacob fears that he will lose it all. So Jacob wrestles all night with God, with an angel, with himself. And the beauty of wrestling with God, when we wrestle with God, is that no one loses. No one loses, but we come out different. Before he's reconciled with his brother, he must first be reconciled with himself, with God, at peace with himself. He is ready to make peace with his brother. And when he finally sees his brother again, his brother Esau runs towards him. The scriptures say, ran to meet Jacob. And he embraces him. And he fell on his neck and he kissed him and then wept. And Esau said to Jacob, take all the animals you have given me. I have enough, brother. And Jacob said to Esau, seeing your face is like seeing the face of God. Seeing your face is like seeing the face of God. That's reconciliation. Seeing the image of God in each other. I used to own a house in Paris, Ontario, near Brantford in Six Nations, the largest reserve in Canada. Had a wonderful old house there, and it was close to the Grand River. Close to the Grand River, which runs from Fergus, I think, all the way to Lake Erie, and it's this huge lake. And I'd heard about something called the Haldimand Track. I'd heard that the Six Nations had an agreement going back to, I think it was 1764, an agreement with the governor at the time, Frederick Haldimand, that they would, if they remained loyal with the British in the American Revolution, they would be given this parcel of land, 950,000 acres of land, 10 kilometers on either side of the Grand River. So 6 miles, they talk about, on either side of the Grand River, would be Six Nations land, forever. And right now there's about 50,000 acres of that 950,000 acres still, you know, occupied by Six Nations. So 900,000 acres have been, over the years, taken away. And I thought, is my house? I tried to measure it. I said, I think I'm within this Haldimand Track. Here is my house on Six Nations land. And so I thought, I want to find this out. I want to reconcile. And I went to Six Nations, and I went to the band council, and I spoke with Chief Ava Hill, and I spoke with somebody else who she had told me about, a man named Fred Hill, who had spent 40 years of his life surveying the Haldimand Track. He said, I can account for every square meter of that track. He's a very gracious man, a wonderful gentleman, and so he said, let's meet at Tim Hortons in Oshwegan, in Six Nations. So we met at Tim Hortons, we started there at a bottle of coffee, and we talked, and after a while he said, let's go back to my office. And he had maps and maps and maps of the Haldimand Track, and even where my house was at, he knew exactly. I said, so my house is on your land. And he said, don't worry, we're not going to camp in your backyard. He said, all we've ever wanted was to be listened to. I said, tell me about this Haldimand Track. And I said, I feel like I should be paying property taxes to Six Nations. I said, shouldn't I be paying property taxes to the... And he said, I've never heard a white man say that before. And he said, located on the banks of the Grand River, the Six Nations is the only reserve in North America where all six Haudenosaunee traditions, the Mohawk and Seneca and others, live together. And on his shelf, he had this shell, this beautiful shell with a spoon in it, one spoon. And he said, we need to share the birthright. We need to share the stew, he said. And he talked about the dish with one spoon treaty, how the Six Nations came together, they were fighting each other, at war with each other, and these Six Nations came together many years ago, and they were at war with one another, and they made peace. And he said, as the tradition goes, the six chiefs shared one bowl of stew. One bowl of stew, and they used the same spoon. And there was enough for all. That sounds like when Jesus fed the multitudes with two fish and five loaves, like we heard last Sunday. Family, what Dr. King called the beloved community, everyone sitting at the same table as brothers and sisters. An opportunity to see each other, to really see each other, to lay down our fear, truth and reconciliation. I remember Fred saying, there's no blueprint for reconciliation. And that's frustrating. Great addiction, he said, is that we are addicted to our own way of thinking, the status quo. Things will never change. And we can sell this opportunity for fear and perhaps shame in what our ancestors did, but with that comes a price to pay. Esau sells his birthright for a bowl of stew. Perhaps the greatest obstacle to reconciliation is the thought that there is nothing that we can do about it. But if love is the goal, if seeing God in each other is the goal, then there is no such thing as failure. Jesus didn't tell us what to see, but how to see. way of life. Reconciliation is an awakening, perhaps a way of life. It starts with seeing the divine in one another and embracing the opportunities that come our way. A few years ago, I had the pleasure of meeting this young lady here, Emma Stevens, who is a Mi'kmaq young person. My friend is a priest in Eskazoni, which is a reserve, one of the five reserves on Cape Breton Island, and just by chance, she was singing in his church. Emma Stevens, a few years ago, when the United Nations declared a year of indigenous languages, recorded this song. Paul McCartney contacted her and was really impressed. So I think this was an opportunity to meet her and to live out reconciliation, to understand one another, and to embrace each other's culture. So hope you enjoy this little video. Ready, Em?
Police get in trouble in tow. And I'm a seat by Jardin. Delbert Dowson. Eskimo de Moose and Egnigan in Jarson. Police get in trouble in tow. All I've been making a milligan. Delbert Dowson. Eskimo no moose and Egnigan say Yasin. Police get Elijah. Dawn was the day when it by two.
Thank you.
This will be the last minute for mission reading until the fall. There's a little video that goes with this, if Stephanie can, should I say, try and bring it up? If it'll come up for us.
All right. Discrimination means it's especially hard for them to access education. In Guatemala, 1 in 4 indigenous women can't read or write. Discrimination means it's especially hard for them to access education, healthcare, and financial stability. Your support helps these women live their best lives. Your gifts to mission and service have a lasting impact on women who are persecuted simply for being who they are. A better world is possible. Thank you for helping to make it happen.
Story. Everyone has a right to express their beliefs, find good work, have a place to live, speak freely, love who they want to, and meet their basic needs. Discrimination strikes at the heart of these core human rights. Although indigenous people living in Guatemala make up nearly half the population, they face discrimination in all facets of their lives. Because of this discrimination, accessing healthcare and education and becoming financially stable is extremely hard, especially for women. According to the Guatemala Conference of Evangelical Churches, 43% of indigenous women living in Guatemala are unable to read and write, compared to 19% of non-indigenous women. That's why your gifts through mission and service support the conference in providing human rights education, as well as business and agricultural training skills for women farmers. Patrona is one of hundreds of women who have changed their lives after receiving training through the conference. She is a member of a gardening group of 6 women. Thanks to your generosity, these women receive seeds, tools, and agricultural training. Today, Instead of making the long walk to the market to buy costly produce, Patrona grows tomatoes and chili peppers a stone's throw away from her home. When we need anything, we just get it from our greenhouse, she says. Katerina, another member of the group, says the greenhouse means children in the community are healthier. If we plant tomatoes, radishes, and chard, these are very good vitamins for our children. We don't see malnourished kids anymore, she says. The gifts you give have a lasting impact on the lives of hardworking indigenous women and their families who face discrimination simply for being who they are. A better world is possible. Thank you for helping to make it happen. And I just wanted to thank all the pie makers and the bakers. From the outreach table, we were thrilled that we raised $590. So that will go to the Peterborough Ukrainian Refugees and the New Canadian Center.
Delights in creation, loves the world,
When we turn towards each other, we see your bright face. When we share each other's burdens, we know your steadfast love. We see you, O God, listening to wise people, playing with children, dining with the outcast, counting sheep with the farmers, welcoming runaway sons, partying with the isolated, loving the unlovable, touching the untouchable, forgiving the unforgivable, taking up what no one else wants to carry. Life-giving, life-loving God, from the sobbing of rain to the laughter of daisies, your glory is everywhere heard and seen. Holy, sprightly Spirit of God, hear us as we offer to you the words of our hearts, words of challenge and the burdens we carry, words of joy for the loved ones who shine and sparkle in our days, words of doubt for those times when you can seem so far away. Yours are the hands in which we are held in grace, O Lord, and so we gather in prayer all your children. In silence or spoken aloud, we continue to pray for those we love. Pray that your loving hand will be felt upon their shoulders. And let us include the world in our prayers, where peace lies wounded, where love has to hide. Let us lift up those places. Lord, we lift up Ukraine. Persistent Spirit, we pray for reconciliation and peace on earth. Heal all that is broken in our hearts, in our streets, in our world. God of holy ground, sacred earth, give your blessing this day to the First Nations peoples of this land. Guide their elders and their communities and give them strength. Give grace and pride to their children as the daughters and sons of your creation. Give us a sense of justice and awareness of the possibility of new beginnings, new covenants created. Lord, we feel the beat of your heart, O Holy One, the turning of the earth, of the seasons of day and night. Challenge us to live out the hope of reconciliation that your love has placed in our hearts. Continue to teach and shape this beloved community here at Westdale, that we may learn to move and live as one body in Christ, dependent on each other's gifts, sharing in each other's hopes. In the wildness, in the commonplace, in the heights and depths of our lives, fill us with hopeful song. Surround us with the sounds of peace. Kindle a flame of courage within us, so we may continue the journey that you have set before us. Generous God, empower us to welcome, forgive, offer your light to the world, heal others in your name. For we pray in the name of your great love for us, one whose name is peace, whose heart is peace, the one whose name is Jesus, the name that fills this place in our hearts and teaches us to sing in prayer.
Thank you.
gift from God. Saints of Westdale, the gift of your life is a gift from God, a source of blessing in this world. So let us glorify God through our gifts. With joy we present offerings of commitment and support for the work of Christ Church right here in Peterborough to the Mission and Service Fund around the world.
Thank you, Reverend Chris. Well, yesterday, for those of you who were around, we had quite an event here. And it was just so wonderful to be able to use our property in a way that was exciting and actually very energizing. Those of you who might have been here would realize that there was a lot of people, there were a lot of people coming and going all morning here, and it was full of energy and excitement and welcoming of people who hadn't seen each other for a long time. And so on behalf of the board, particularly, I want to thank Paul Mitchell and Kim Fenton and their events committee that really originated the idea, and then all of the people who participated. We didn't know we had a professional clown in our midst who brought people in off the street. I mean, that's the mission of the church, isn't it? Bring people in off the street. So anyways, to all of those who participated and helped, both out in the parking area and particularly in Henderson Hall, where food and drink were available, I think the vendors found it profitable. I don't know if we have an additional amount. Paul, do we have any? Well, there you go. So over $700 as a part of the fundraiser for the church, in addition to Janice's announcement for the Mission and Service project as a part of that. It was an exciting day, and I want to thank everybody who put their effort into being here and helping with the event. And lastly, I think it's appropriate, Chris, to acknowledge that this is the last Sunday for the choir. So you're all dismissed.
If I could just add to that, John, if anyone was not here, please get a chance to check out the items in room, classroom 2. Please have the church have a look. There may be a treasure there that you're dying to take home.
One last treasure treat, if you like. And in addition to that, there's leftovers of muffins and cookies and ice coffee. Is that what it is, Marilyn? So please make your way to Henderson Hall after the service today. But as I was saying, we want to acknowledge the work of Brenda and the choir during the course of the normal year, because this is the abnormal summer, I guess. And we want to recognize their commitment of practicing every week and being here and leading us in music. So thank you very much, and on behalf of
wisdom you are sent, so in faith we go.
May God grant you the grace to never sell yourself short, the grace to risk something big for the sake of something good, the grace to remember that the world is too big for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. And may you see the face of Christ in everyone you meet, and may everyone you meet see the face of Christ in you. Amen.
Music in the summer, so don't stop coming because there's still going to be music.